Everybody's here now, so I'll just say again, I'm Joe Wyatt. I work downstairs in communication and marketing. I'm here to talk about public relations and why it's important to the college. And you know, as a reflection of that, what I do and how I promote the college and persuade the community that we're, you know, worthy, that's something that can carry over into many kinds of public relations, whether you work for the Texas Rangers publicity department, or you know, a steel company or a communications firm or whatever. You're selling a product like Heinz soup, you know, you really do care that the public and the people, the consumers, the constituents, if you will, they see your product or your company in a positive light. And so public relations is largely a persuasive kind of an industry or career, as if you will. You know, my job is to persuade people that we are an institution that's deserving of your attention and your goodwill and your use. We want people to use the college, right? So we're set up to serve people from age, you know, infant to there's no limit. And so we want to, you know, people not just in a specific category to like us, but you know, it's much broader than that. I think if you were selling, you know, roller skates, you would like roller skaters to like you the best. You know, we're selling education to everybody, an opportunity to everybody. So we have no limits on who is our constituency, what is the audience that's listening to us. It's everybody that lives here in Amarillo and a little bit beyond. You may be from Amarillo or beyond, but we serve about 8 counties in our district, and so that's our primary audience. But as you know, we're all connected in the Texas Panhandle, so even the counties that border and are beyond, the ones that are known as the Amarillo College District, are also people that are using us, relying on us. And so anyway, that's the importance of our persuasive efforts are to reach everybody in the Panhandle. And that's largely it. You know, if the New York Times were to call on us and want to know a little bit about us, we would not say, oh, sorry, you're not in our district, you're not in our region, you know, but largely they don't call, you know, and they're not interested in us. So you know, we kind of know where our audience is and where the people are that are listening to us and so forth. So anyways, my job is communications coordinator. And so I try to coordinate our communications in a way that gets the biggest bang for the buck of what you would might say is my salary and the efforts that we as a department downstairs put into reaching out. And so we write press releases, we put on events, we market the college as well, because we're communication and marketing. So marketing are things sometimes that you would pay for, right? You might pay for a billboard or an advertisement on the TV or in the newspaper. And that's money you expend to hit a target audience to, and you know about marketing, right? So you see a billboard up and it says Amarillo College, and you say, oh, Amarillo College, they're putting the word out, they're spending a little money, you know? And it's strategically perpetrated, if you will. But, you know, public relations isn't so much the expending of money, it's the persuading. It's the, you know, you can get, it costs us virtually nothing to put out a press release that says, hey, we're great in regard to this or this. And we would love for the world to know that we're great at this or this. And so we would invite you, the TV station, the newspaper, the radio, to come down here and point out that we're great at this, right? And so that cost us very little. A little time, a little effort, but then they come on down, hopefully, if you've done a good job, and they want to expound on the greatness that you claim, or refute it if they so desire. But you know, if you're doing a good job and if you truly are great, then it's it's pretty hard to refute that greatness. And so, for example, today at 10 o'clock, I can't get much out of that clock, can I? At 10 o'clock, I'm going to be leaving here and going to speak to a reporter from Channel 7 that's interested in the fact that our regents this last week, approved the hiring of an architect to design a greenhouse for our biology department, and we're going to expand our programs in biology. You know about this. And so what is interesting about it is that we got a grant last September, a multi-million-dollar grant, to expand our biology resources, and inclusive in that grant was the money to basically build up a greenhouse and add programs in this greenhouse, okay? So programs that we don't have in, like, horticulture and biochemistry and things where they can do research. So we can expand what we offer in biology and the sciences. So that's great. But just the other night, we had the regents approve the hiring of an architect to design the greenhouse. Well, that's news, I guess, you know, right? But we got the grant in September, and at that time, all the TV stations came down and said, ooh, you know, this is a big deal. And it is, and it was, and it still is. But, you know, we're going to hire an architect now. The architect, we know their name, but we didn't, like, draw a drawing yet of the building, and we don't know where the building's going to necessarily go. So what can you do in a news follow-up, right? And so we put out a little press release just saying we hired this architect, but it reminded people, or reminded the media, that we came into this money back in September. And lo and behold, they want to come down today and do a story about it. And what we can provide for them basically is a talking head from the biology department who can then spell out for them a little bit more in depth what new programs we'll design and offer. But we don't have a drawing. We can't show what the greenhouse is going to look like, right? We can't show them where it's going to be located. And so, you know, it's great because we didn't expend anything but a little bit of energy to remind them, you know, that we're having this occur sometime in the future, and they want to come down and do a story about it. And the only disappointing thing is that I wish I could show them the drawing or show them where it's going to be located or show them, you know, video is what they want, and instead they're going to get the talking head that your poor student is watching right now. So I'm going to move around a little. But so what we did was we told them the complete and utter truth. You know, we hired an architect, and then reminded them why we're getting an architect and why we need a greenhouse. And that was enough to encourage them to come on down. Maybe it's a slow news day or whatever, but public relations is strategic, and it's vital that it be, I guess for lack of a better way of putting it, completely honest, okay? If I wanted to get all the news media down here, I could do so in a heartbeat of a few white lies, you know, because they're always looking, you know, if I said, well, you know, it's interesting right now that the President of the United States has an immigration policy that's banning travel, and it's going to affect our college like never before. I can have the media here in about 5 minutes. I just have to tweet that. But that's not true. It's just simply not true. And when the media called yesterday to see how it's going to affect our college, I basically had to tell them, you should really call the university in Canyon where they have these issues. We don't. Our people that are students at this college that come from foreign lands, if you want to call them immigrants, refugees in some cases, they're basically our neighbors. And so we don't have formal agreements that we did back a decade ago that entitled them, or what it did, we had a form that had to be filled out by students that were from other countries back a decade ago so that they could show it to their consulate so that they could prove they had an agreement with a specific university or college in this country, and so they could come and go visa-wise as related to that. Well, we don't have that anymore, and for 10 years we haven't needed that. And so it's not applicable here to us, but with a little white lie, I could have the news media down here in a heartbeat. So this brings me to the foundation of my little white lie story. And so I put on the board for you this thing that I hope you can see it. It's just my idea of the scale of lies, okay? This is the lie scale, and this is the little white lie way over here, right here. And this is the bold-faced lie right here, okay? So I bring it to you in this fashion, you know, like as if we're all largely guilty, right, of something in this neighborhood, right? Grandmother comes in and says, "How do you like my new hairdo?" And it's preposterous, okay? It looks really zany. It makes her look like a cartoon figure. But you don't want to hurt her feelings. She's your grandmother. And you go, "Love it, Grandma. Love your hairdo." So you've just committed a little white lie about down there on the scale, right? And you know, something up here, you know, it might be that if you're on a beautiful summer day and you look up and you say, "Oh, that sky is just pink." You know, I mean, okay, that's ridiculous. But that would be completely way over here, right? Because you know, I mean, that's just flat out a lie. So anyway, what it is you've got this scale of lies, and we're all just human beings, and so we're all going to be somewhere on this scale sometime during our lifetimes, if not every day. You know, "Hey, how you doing?" "Oh, I'm great." But you're going through a divorce and you can't pay your car payment. "Yeah, but I'm great." Okay, so because you don't want to get into the weeds on it, right? So you don't. So you're in here somewhere, maybe. Okay, and sometimes you're going, "Gee, you know, we have the greatest biology program in the land, better than MIT and Harvard. That's why we're getting a greenhouse." Okay, I think we can say that on the halfway mark. Here's half the 50-yard line, you know, you're starting to get a little bit ridiculous over here, right? Now, we're trying to get people interested in our greenhouse or our other programs down here, and we want coverage, and we're starting some new things, we've got some good old things, and we're trying to sell that stuff to get it in the public eye. You better stay pretty far down here if you're going to retain what we call credibility. And credibility in public relations is everything, I assure you. Credibility is everything. So if you get caught on this side of the 50-yard line on more than one occasion, one might sink your ship, but on more than one occasion, okay, now there's a pattern of behavior here, and your credibility is right here. They can't trust what you say. I won't bring up any names, but I've seen some national headlines lately that suggest that this strategy might work for some. But in this town, at this institution, can I get away with bold-faced lies to the media and retain credibility with them? No. And what would happen if I lose credibility with the media and I say, I represent this institution, so I'm being a spokesperson for this institution. If I'm going to be seen as a liar, if I'm going to be willing to risk our credibility as an institution, then it's not just the news media that will be reporting such behaviors, but it's the domino theory. It's the people that we serve. How about the people we want to hire? How about when Madison Fowler retires and we need to replace with the best, you know, mass comm teacher we can find, but no one wants to apply here because they don't want to be associated with a bunch of liars? I mean, you know, it's not just that the media will say, "Hey, those people aren't very honest over there," but how about the students we're trying to recruit? We want you to come out of here with holding your head high. "I graduate from Amarillo College." You know, that should mean something, but not if they're a bunch of liars. So, I want you to think about your own personal situation. And when you're in an industry, a public relations role someday, perhaps, who knows, right? And so you know that this exists, the 50-yard line. And there's little white lies that are what we deem acceptable in life and so forth. and there's crossing even this much over to the other side that sometimes you might expect to be asked to do. You've seen or heard stories, and I don't have a specific example, but just say, you know, you're working for the dog food industry, right? And they want you to go out as the public relations spokesperson and say, you know, we use nothing but natural products. And you know that we got a little plastic, a few bones, some stuff that might not even be considered natural. Okay, you know it's in there, but it's probably undetectable and you'll get away with it. You could just say, you know, nothing but 100% natural products in our dog food. And they want you to say that. And you might get away with it. But it's like suddenly up to you. You know, it's your it's your goodwill now that you're willing to risk, okay? Am I going to, I need this paycheck, right? I like working for this dog food company. They want me to go out and say it's 100% natural. Who's going to make that call besides you? I mean, you have to make it. You have to decide. And so, the world is not a perfect place, right? And so, if I were asked to go down to a press conference right now and say that, you know, Amarillo College will have 100% graduation rate this next year. 100%. No problem. We had 100% last year. So why wouldn't we repeat, right? I mean, it's ridiculous, but I mean, it's clearly it wouldn't be the truth. And if I were asked to do that, you know what I would say? I like to think, no, get somebody else to say that. Because I'm not saying it. I know it's not true. You know? And they might say, then you, sir, can go find work elsewhere. I mean, you know, it could happen. I mean, it's all theoretical and ridiculous. But, you know, that's what I'm saying, is that you might be asked in public relations to represent in a misrepresentative kind of way. And so you personally have to know where you're going to draw your line and what you're willing to pass to be in public relations, because without credibility, you won't last long. It's just a fact. So that's why at Amarillo College, our MO, our strategy is to be completely honest and forthright and tell the story as best we can. Now, there's also lies through omission. And so sometimes people that are hired to persuade, which is what public relations does, it persuades. And hopefully it persuades for the betterment of your institution that you represent and also the people that institution serves, whether it's the dog food users or the people in the public that need educated and so forth. It's all the same. You have the people that you're serving as an industry, and you have your industry. And you like to think that when you do this persuading, it's beneficial to all, because they need the information, so they'll have it better in their head what their choices are. You need them to know the level of expertise that you have, or the greatness that you claim. You want them to know about it, so that's all beneficial, mutually beneficial. So I think that without credibility, you're sunk. And at this institution, we try to stay as much on top of the truth as we possibly can. And yet, there are times, through omission, I think, that you would say, your institution, your dog food company, or your Amarillo College, or your U.S. government, or whatever, let's not tell them this. You know, let's not tell them this one thing, because they didn't ask about it. They don't need to know about it, because, you know, really, that's not our best thing, you know? That's not our best thing. I mean, we love this thing here. See, we love this, and we want them to know about this. This is a four-star thing, you know? Now, true, you know, there's this. But, you know, as long as no one cares about it, we won't bring it up. Now, we can't avoid that. If they bring it up, if they say, hey, I heard, though, that, you know, blah, blah, you say, oh, well, it's true. It's true. We, you know, might not even say, we weren't going to bring that up, you know, but, and you know, you could probably use a better example than this, you know, we just won a major award, okay? We just won a major award, and we want the world to know that we won a major award. There was only one nominee for the award, and we nominated him, and that was us. But who cares about that? Because, you know, we won a major award over here, and we want that in the paper, okay? Now, that may not be exactly what happens, but that's a good example of something that I'm trying to, you know, illustrate, just an illustration that we won a major award. We don't want all the specifics known, but if you bring it up and say, well, we heard you're the only nominee, we'll say, well, it's true. But on the good side is, we were the only ones worthy of being nominated. And that's why we took it upon ourselves to nominate ourselves, you know. And so you know, that would be an example of a lie through omission that we could live with, okay? That we could live with. We not only nominated ourselves and won the award, but we're not going to tell you that there was one other nominee, but we went down to their company and pulled the plug on their electricity when they weren't looking. I mean, that's some heinous thing of, you know, then we belong over here, right? So we're not doing anything sinister. But, you know, that's what we do at Amarillo College, is try to tell the story of how great we are and how great the people are. And if we're asked about stuff that we're not putting out press releases about, stuff that we don't particularly want shouted from the highest mountaintops, but we're asked about it, we try to stand up and respond in a way that would make us all feel better about Amarillo College. Not everywhere is perfect. You know, we've had closures of certain programs here over the years, not recently. I remember when our mortuary science program was de-accredited or lost its accreditation. And the administration at the time, which isn't the administration now, they knew this was coming down the pike. And they really basically didn't want to dwell on it. And they, you know, they basically thought if they didn't say anything about it, maybe it'll just go quietly away and no one will find out about it. But accreditation agencies don't work that way, and by and large, when a department or a program at a college or university loses its individual accreditation, and they all have their own accreditations. The nursing has to answer to the National Nursing Board, and the mortuary science to the national, even the machinists, and you know, all our programs have individual accreditations. When they're lost, it becomes a matter of public record. And when we lost our accreditation for mortuary science, and by the way, it's back and it's solid and it's fine right now, and has been for a while. But when we lost that, they thought, well, no one will find out. And when the cat was let out of the bag, without any marketing / public relations preparation or awareness, no crisis plan put into effect, then the headline on the Amarillo Globe News was about this big. It said, AC loses accreditation. Now that's ridiculous, because it was the one mortuary science program that has, what, 30 students in it or something, and is on the West Campus. But because we had no plan in place, we paid big time for that. Because that giant headline that says AC loses accreditation, how many people just read the headline and move on, right? How many people read a sentence or something and then turn the page? You know, all of us at times. And so when you put out AC loses accreditation, it's like AC out of business. AC done. Forget about them. Well, so you have to have crisis communications plans, and you have to discuss things when they're approaching crisis, you know, levels like that. The administration thought, no one will find out, we'll just fix it over here. it'll be fine. Well, it didn't. I mean, they fixed it and it was fine, but not until it became a public issue and a big mess. And crisis communications are important. And we have crisis plans at this college, and everybody that is interested in public relations anywhere has similar or meaningful public crisis communication plans. And a crisis is defined in many different ways, right? So you have a crisis of, say, you're selling cars and the airbags don't work, right? It's a crisis. You're going to recall 100,000 cars to fix their airbags, and now nobody wants to buy that kind of a car, so you have to have a plan, right? So you can still continue to sell these cars. Well, at this college, we have plans for if a tornado hits, you know, if a madman comes stomping through with an AK-47, right? I mean, we have all kind of plans what we're going to do in a crisis physically to dig people out of the rubble or to duck and cover or keep the door locked, right? Or different things like that. But when the dust clears, when the last bullet's been fired or whatever, now people want to know, why did you let that happen? Why did you let a tornado come right down through that building? Did you not prepare for that? What are you going to tell them? I mean, you're up there and the lights and the microphones and they're all clicking away and they're going, three people were killed in that building. Did you not hear the siren? You know? And what are you telling me? My child died over there and these people are dead? You know, whatever. There's no right answer, right? There's no way out of it. A madman bursts in and shoots all of us. Okay? And downstairs the next day they're saying, well, you know, the door was locked. Yeah, well, still, you know, was there no one patrolling out here with a gun? I mean, nothing you can do is going to be good enough. Nothing you can do is going to be good enough. At Virginia Tech, when they had that, you know, I mean, that's what kind of started. I mean, we had other incidents, but, you know, that's the famous one. That's the start when mass murder occurred at Virginia Tech, and that institution ended up paying out gazillions of dollars because they didn't do anything right. And frankly, all the manuals that have been written since by every government agency and every institution, and everyone's trying to make it perfect, you know, nobody will get it right. That's what everyone admits. I mean, we're correcting all these things that Virginia, I mean, it's been clearly stated by the U.S. government, Virginia Tech did this wrong, this wrong, this wrong, this wrong. They weren't prepared. They didn't put out enough alerts. They didn't respond fast enough. They didn't let enough people know. Their umbrella wasn't big enough. All these things. And everybody who's since sat down and tried to draw up their own plan, according to the government specifications, goes, there's no way we can do enough. We can't do enough. We can't fix it, right? We can't fix it because nobody can predict when the door will fly open and the bullets will fly, right? Nobody can predict which one of us is armed right now with a secret, you know, sinister weapon. And none of us can predict when a meteor comes flying through that cloud and strikes the building and knocks three of us dead. And yet, they're going to ask, hey, everybody else, they're going to question, did they do it right? How could it have happened that they didn't know there was a meteor coming out of the sky? And so you're going to be hard-pressed sometimes. And you have to be able to say confidently that we did everything that we could. We prepared, and here's our preparation guide. You know, we have this map right here, and it says, all A, B, we did A, we did B, we did C, we did D. We did E twice, because we like E. I'm just saying. You know, so that's crisis communications in a nutshell, if you ask me. You can't do it right, and you can't do it enough, and you've got to do it, and you've got to be prepared for those being those disasters. Now, we did talk about mortuary science. That wasn't that kind of a life-threatening, kind of ironic, mortuary sign. Wasn't a life-threatening crisis. But, you know, that's the kind of crisis that could be controlled were the headlines, "Don't mock us," because we were ready. And we went to them, and they didn't find out that we lost our accreditation. We told them. That's how you're supposed to do it. That's how it's, that's public relations 101. You know you're going to lose your accreditation, you stop everything and call them on the phone and say, "Hey, you better come down here. I got to tell you some really bad news. Fortunately, we have a plan to fix it." Here's how it happened. Oh my gosh, can you believe we were this stupid? But, you know, and unfortunate at the same time. You know, not just stupid. We were unfortunate because we know what we're doing. You know, and you explain it out and you handle your own problems that way. And when they say, "Why did it reach that level where it couldn't be corrected?" You flat out say, "I made a mistake." Whoever it was that made the mistake has to come out and say, "It was my fault. I did bad. Oh, what was I thinking? I'm sorry. I'm going to fix it. I'm working overtime tonight, tomorrow night, how many ever nights it takes." And that's how you do crisis communication. And that's how we try to do stuff like that here. And I think most normal folk think along those same lines. They don't want you to know some stuff. They don't necessarily offer you stuff they don't want you to know. But we're by and large employed to get you to like our stuff and to be persuaded that what we're doing is good. And so we put out press releases, stories, just public information, not all of which we expect to be followed up on. We might do a feature on this young lady over here, how she likes to bring a water bottle over there to class and wear her sunglasses on her head while she's, you know, I mean, and that might be of interest to somebody, you know what I mean? It's like, what's this person all about? We don't expect the news media to come running down and do a story, but we like our constituents. We like the people we serve, whether it be students we have, students we'd like to have, grandmothers who sent a grandchild here once or went here once back in the 30s, whatever. We want them to all know that people over here are cool, different, unique, have stories. And why not, if you've got a little time, do a little feature story on somebody that's of interest, on a program that's a little bit unique, on some things where people are having fun. Every once in a while, somebody in the media might pick it up as a little, you know, carrot and say, "Hey, I think that was a cool story. I'd like to follow up on that." But by and large, we don't expect that. We expect them to just tackle the bigger issues, you know, the greenhouses we want to build, right? And so, I mean, that's a big deal. It may land on somebody's yard over here and they don't even know it yet. I mean, I don't know. Or at least become the neighbor of somebody. But we are surprised from time to time on who takes the bait, so to speak, who wants to follow up on a story that we thought was just of interest, not a news story. But Amarillo was not Chicago. And in Chicago, they have bigger fish to fry. Here in Amarillo, we have what's called the slow news day. From time to time. Would never happen at the Ranger. But are there any questions you would like to ask me? Can you believe, would you rather ask the administration where they got this wacko dude? I understand that. I will, just because my presentation, you know, needs help, I'll show you like some stuff that I do. Like, sometimes I get writer's block. So I go out and I take strange pictures of me doing weird stuff, like washing my car. And so I point this out to you because I like to show myself off in these strange pictures. But, you know, and oh, here's one, because it's me putting a banana peel on the stairs in front of Jenna's dad. I like to write, and I have to write. And that's what my job entails the most of, is I write. And so that may change and so forth over the years, and your kids may not even ever have to pick up a writing implement. But, you know, the message is the message, and you have to put it in some paragraphs if you're going to deliver it to the people that you want to know your message. And you can make videos, and we do it. And you can tweet, and we do it. But, you know, there's a lot more to meeting Friday at 8. What's the meeting for? You know, where's it going to be at? How long is it going to last? Who's going to be there? Why should you come? You know, and you've got to write it down. So I write constantly for a living, and that's mostly what I do. I'm a writer. I went to school and got a journalism degree at West Texas State University, now the A&M. And I worked at the Globe News for a few years and other newspapers in West Texas. And then I worked for 10 years at West Texas A&M in basically the job I have now. And this is my 9th year here. And every day, almost, for 19 years in the higher education industry, and for at least 12 years before that in newspapers, I'm like this. Get the facts, you know, put them into some kind of understandable format, and share it with people. And I take pictures that are strange of me doing stuff because it's just a hobby I developed when I got writer's block, because you just can't, you know, I mean, I'm Stephen King, I am not. I have to stop and, you know, I dizzy myself with these facts of biology, greenhouses. What do I know biology? I'm a journalist. What do they do? What's a biochemist do? I don't know. But I have to kind of like tell people what they do for a living. I have to find out all these things, whether it's welding one day, nursing the next, biology the next. And then there's all these state regulations that we have to comply with in all, you know, I mean, just a myriad of things, and budgets and state budgets. And how do you understand all that? Well, you just try as best you can. What you want to do is share it with people so that when they look at it, they don't have like all these questions. They just say, oh, I get it. I get it. In a nutshell, I get it. And when I have writer's block, I make strange pictures of myself, and it's fun to do. And I had a blog for a year where I had a different picture of Joe every day. I mean, that was the name of it, a different picture of Joe every day. And if you Google that, it'll pop up, and you'll see 365 pictures of me. Here's a good one. I almost like think that might be a felony. But my grandkid was getting out of line, and I thought I'd straighten him up. But so anyways, I do strange things like that because everything else tends, at least at times, to be kind of serious. So what can I tell you about the world of public relations or Amarillo College? You are a journalist. You must have a pressing question.
What is the most difficult question you've ever had to answer to from the media?
Well, there has been a couple of what you would call unhappy occasions. One time at West Texas A&M, we had discovered a fetus, which is, I guess, a human about this big, in a woman's room commode. And so we had to put out a press release that, you know, being proactive, that we found this fetus in there because it was pretty widely known. Somebody went in there and said, hey, I'm reporting this, I think that's something. And so once you have that, it's kind of a public information type of thing, and you go on the offensive and say, hey, we found this, because honestly, if they start calling you and say, we heard you found this, and you hem and haw, now you're getting headlines for 3 days. Better you get them for one. Wasn't something we were proud of. It's nothing we did, you know, as an institution. It's just, it was discovered in this commode, there was a fetus. Well, then, a funeral director, they had a funeral for this fetus. And, you know, I don't know anything about human forms and how they develop, I mean, I don't know. But the funeral director was quoted in the story in the paper of the service that was had for this fetus, that it was just adorable, so cute. Well, you know, it's like a little worm. Okay, I mean, I'm just saying. I mean, so, like, it almost came off of that darn institution down there murdered this baby. And isn't it a shame? Isn't it a shame? Couldn't they have done better? So we had to call the State Association of Funeral Directors and put in our 2 cents that we thought that was inappropriate. And anyway, that was difficult because, you know, it's whether it was somebody or not, I don't know and don't have an opinion on, but it was somebody's something. And so, you know, you hate to quarrel with or trample on or you know, add insult to any kind of an injury. But on the other hand, you're talking about this place I work at here, of being inept. We're not inept. We care. You know, I mean, so that was a tough situation there, having to deal with that. Then, of course, this mortuary science thing. I mean, my whole office was at our once-a-year convention for community college marketing and communication professionals in Kansas City, Missouri. My whole office. And we get a call at this convention from the Globe News reporter that was covering us at the time, and they said, well, what's this about your mortuary science program losing its accreditation? We said, what? First we'd ever heard of it. Okay? First heard of it. Apparently been going on for like 8 months or 9 months of double secret probation, never knew about it, fix it or else, never knew about it, fire the guy that caused it, never heard about it, until you just can't have accreditation anymore. Well, that, you know, if you're in a program, say halfway through it, and then it loses its accreditation, now you're looking to graduate from a place without accreditation, which makes your certificate or degree about as worthwhile as one of those pictures of me. I mean, you can't get much for it on a street corner, right? So that was brutal. That was brutal. And then to have to deal with our own institutional attorney, who, when I went to the meeting to see how we were going to fix this, the guy says to me, are you going to put this in the Ranger? You know, somebody don't even know, you know, that we have a public relations team in place, or didn't at the time. So to be ignored like that, I mean, it cost us a lot of problems as an institution. That was difficult.
How do you approach, like, controversial subjects like that without, you know, wanting to be biased or making the institution look bad, I guess, in a sense?
Well, one thing is that, you know, you have to maintain truth, but it doesn't mean, you know, that, I mean, clearly everyone that receives missives from the institution know that the institution authored them, okay? I mean, they expect us to say Amarillo College did the right thing. Amarillo College is going to do the right thing. They expect us to say that, but, and so, we that write it have to believe that we are indeed doing the right thing or are going to do the right thing. And so, thankfully, at this place, that's an easy confidence to have. You know, because everyone that works here realizes that if you get on this side of this lie scale more than one occasion, then that's going to be the story from then on out. Not, we won the award. It's, we must have lied to win the award. Not that we became a leader college, we must have lied to become a leader college. You know what I mean? Because they'll never let you get back to the other side. So, I don't know that that answers your question, but I mean, it's like you have to put your institution in the best possible light. But it's only the possible light that's within the realm of possibility. And the possibilities are only as broad as truth will allow. You can't just say, mortuary science, we didn't lose our accreditation. Are you kidding? They made that up. It's not going to work. So you just have to own it. I don't know what time it is. It looks like 5 to 6.
I don't know what time it is either.
4 to 6.
9:48. Does anybody have any other questions?
Have you ever been put in a situation that you almost crossed the line? You had to make that decision yourself, whether you were going to say what they told you to or live with your conscience.
Well, let me think. Probably. You know, sometimes, especially with personnel issues, you will be aware of some reason that somebody no longer works at your institution. And that's not just here, but wherever. But we are a public tax-funded institution, right? So that makes us different from your Ralston Purina Corporation. In other words, some things are public information that we have to share, whereas a private company wouldn't have to. And lots of times when we change personnel, especially high up, you know, when a dean suddenly leaves, when a vice president suddenly doesn't work there anymore, there's oftentimes extenuating circumstances to which we do sometimes, whether we even like it or not, become privy to those kinds of details, you know, and we say something like, because they're looking at other opportunities, because they, you know, had a better offer, or, you know, they're going to spend more time with their grandkids, you know, I don't know, you know, but that's not usually the reason. But because of certain rules and regs, like, you know, you can't talk about somebody's personnel issues, you know, it's private, so you know why they've basically been told, you know, resign or you're getting fired, you know, and usually they resign. It happens. There's too many people involved for it not to happen sometimes. And so sometimes, maybe with personnel issues, you know, they're writing something in the newspaper, for example, that you know would make your institution look so much better if you could just tell them the truth. But you can't. It's against the law. You know, it's somebody's private matters. And even though that person would look better if the truth came out, you can't say it. It's just like medical records, you know? We don't talk about somebody else's medical records, right? It's against the law. It's private. It's personal. It's the way it is. And so, and student records are the same thing, you know? I can't just pass out your grades to the media. It's none of their business. It's only your business, you know what I mean? And so there's certain things that are private. And so I would say that those are the issues where we come close, because we want sometimes to say, you know, this is why. It's a completely innocent reason. It looks like, oh, they were stealing all the money at the college and we had to kick them out. But we can't tell them it was just because of this. It had nothing to do with that. And so that makes it tough sometimes. It would make everybody's life easier if we could just reveal certain things that are meant to be secret. Complicates our lives. And aren't they complicated enough?
Okay, so no one has anything else?
Thank you so much for having me here.
Thank you, guys. Let's show our appreciation.